JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's Daily Market Review for February the 27th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, Senior Market Analyst here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, today I will talk again about the coronavirus, which continued hurting market sentiment as cases outside China surpassed cases in China. I will also talk about the euro, which was the main G10 gainer, the pound, which was among the losers, and the Aussie, which was the main loser. Now, as for today's data, we get the US durable goods orders, the US second estimate of GDP for the fourth quarter of 2019, US pending home sales for January, and the initial jobless claims for last week. Now, as for tonight, we get the usual end of month data dump from Japan. As always, let's start with the performance of the US dollar against the other G10 currencies. The dollar traded mixed against the other G10s on Wednesday and during the Asian morning Thursday. It gained against the Aussie, the pound, the Canadian dollar, NOK and NZD in that order, while it underperformed versus the euro, the Swiss franc, the yen and the Swedish krona. The performance in the FX sphere suggests that investors kept short selling equities and risk-linked assets in favor of the safe havens. You can see here that risk-linked currencies, the Aussie and the Kiwi, remained underselling interest, while the safe havens, the Swiss franc and the yen, remained supported. However, looking at the equity world, we see that major EU indices traded unchanged or positive. That said, remember that on Tuesday morning we noted that even if equities rebound, we will treat such a move as a corrective bounce. Indeed, this appears to be the case as the relief was short-lived. During the US session, fears of the coronavirus turning into pandemic resurfaced after New York health officials said that they were monitoring 83 people who traveled to China and may have been infected. Both the S&P 500 and Dow Jones Industrial Average ended the day 0.38 and 0.46% lower. That's much slower than Tuesday, but still marks the fifth consecutive day in negative waters. Nasdaq was the exception, finishing slightly positive, 0.17%. Now, with the number of new cases outside China surpassing those in China for the first time since the outbreak, the negative investor morale rolled over into the Asian session today. Oddly enough, or perhaps due to China's lower numbers, Shanghai's composite gained 0.11%. However, Japan's Nikkei 225 and South Korea's KOSPI fell 2.13% and 1.05% respectively. Looking at the numbers on a global scale, although deaths remained in a slowdown mode, the cases returned into acceleration. This suggests that the worst is not behind us yet, and thus we will stick to our guns that with the virus now feared that it will have a greater and longer impact on the global economy than previously believed, there is still room for equities and risk-linked currencies like the Aussie and the Kiwi to keep sliding, while safe havens like the yen, the franc, gold and bonds may continue to be the beneficiaries. Now passing the ball to the energy market, oil prices fell as well, with Brent and WTI losing 3.86 and 2.99% respectively yesterday, and kept declining today during the Asian day as well. Increasing worries over a pandemic raised speculation that crude demand will slump more than previously anticipated. Participants may also believe that OPEC and its allies may need to proceed with deeper production cuts when they meet next week. However, Saudi Arabia's energy minister said recently that the cartel has not decided yet on whether it should extend or modify its current agreement, adding further pressure on the black liquids. Now back to the currencies, the euro was the main gainer among the G10s, coming under buying interest after reports suggested that Germany's finance ministry is seriously considering to boost fiscal spending due to growing pressure to support the nation's sluggish economy. The euro had been in a sliding mode from the beginning of the month and up until last Thursday, perhaps on speculation that the soft economic data out of the euro area may put pressure on ECB policymakers to ease further. However, fiscal stimulus will alleviate some of that pressure, and that's why the euro recovered decently yesterday. Now, the opposite story stands for the pound. Remember that when Sajid Javid resigned from the position of Chancellor of the Exchequer, the British currency gained on speculation that his successor, Rishi Sunak, will push for more spending at the March budget announcement and thereby lessen the need for a Bank of England rate cut. However, yesterday reports pointed to a potential delay of such decision. Given that fiscal support in the UK is now in doubt, investors may have brought forth their bets with regards to a Bank of England rate cut, and that's why the pound slid, taking the second place among the losers. According to the CME MPC futures, investors are now more than fully pricing in a rate cut to be delivered in August. The Aussie was the main loser among the G10s. Apart from the risk of trading, the commodity-linked currency may have also been pressured by data showing that business investment unexpectedly fell during the last 3 months of 2019, raising concerns that the GDP growth data due out next week may reveal a slowdown, something which may prompt the RBA to cut interest rates earlier than previously anticipated. According to the ASX 30-day interbank cash rate futures implied yield curve, a quarter point rate decrease is now almost fully priced in for the June meeting. Now, what we mentioned with regards to the currencies make us believe that Euro GBP may have decent chances to continue drifting higher, while the Aussie is likely to continue underperforming, especially if sentiment continues to deteriorate. If this is the case, we would prefer to exploit any Aussie weakness against the safe havens like the yen and the Swiss franc. Having said that, though, we will still hold some reservations with regards to the yen, as it could take off its safe haven suit again if concerns over the performance of the Japanese economy resurface. Now, as for today's events, during the afternoon we get the US durable goods orders for January and the second estimate of the US GDP for the fourth quarter. With regards to durable goods, headline sales are expected to have declined 1.5% month over month after rising 2.4% the month before, while the core rate is anticipated to have risen to -0.1% from -0.8%. The second estimate of the US GDP is expected to confirm its initial estimate, namely that the economy grew 2.1% quarter over quarter, seasonally adjusted annual rate, the same pace as in the third quarter. In our view, even if we get a small deviation, the market is unlikely to react massively on this release. After all, we already have models pointing to how the economy has been performing during the first quarter of 2020. The Atlanta Fed GDP Now model points to a growth rate of 2.6%, while the New York Nowcast suggests that the economy has been growing at a 2% pace. In any case, the quarter is not over yet and those numbers are still subject to revisions. The US pending home sales for January and the initial jobless claims for last week are also coming out. Now, as for tonight, we get the usual end of month data dump from Japan. Both the unemployment rate and the jobs to applicants ratio for the month of January are expected to have held steady at 2.2% and 1.57% respectively, while both the preliminary industrial production and retail sales for the month are anticipated to have declined at a faster pace than in December. Specifically, industrial production is expected to have tumbled 9.5% year-over-year after sliding 3.1% in December, while retail sales are forecast to have declined 3.3% year-over-year after falling 3%. The Tokyo CPIs for February are also coming out. The headline rate is expected to have increased to 0.8% from 0.6%, while the core one is anticipated to have remained unchanged at 0.9% year-over-year. Now, with regards to the speakers, we have four on today's agenda: ECB Vice President Luis de Guindos, ECB Executive Member Philip Lane, Bank of England Deputy Governor for Financial Stability John Conliffe, and Chicago Fed President Charles Evans. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. I hope you have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 8 o'clock a.m. GMT time. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye from me, and have a great day.
JFT, just fair and direct.